Today we're talking about Jared Kushner again. Because, well, he seems to be assigned every job that involves doing something that the media doesn't care about. The specific bill we're talking about today is prison reform, because they want to give Manafort a nice place to retire. 3 months ago we saw...
You might think there's nothing Democrats and Republicans agree on anymore, but our very own Van Jones is supporting Jared Kushner's prison reform bill, which just passed the House with broad bipartisan support.
That was a huge victory for bipartisan legislation that unfortunately didn't happen above the erupting Hawaiian volcano, so nobody noticed. So why am I talking about it today? Well, in some news that nobody is reporting, that's right, your options are either read about it or watch this video. This prison reform bill is coming up for a vote in the Senate, and unsurprisingly, not everyone's a fan. So before we talk about the criticism of the bill, what is it? Let's take a look into Jared Kushner's bill, HR 5682. Oh my god, it's so hard to care. Don't worry though, HR 5682 is its dad's name. Its friends call it First Step Act. And clearly, this will be the ultimate solution to our prison problems, because they called it First Step. Liberals, if you're watching this expecting to get angry at Donald Trump, prepare to be disappointed. This bill is focused on reducing America's prison population by rewarding good behavior for incarcerated prisoners.
Working together, we can restore the rule of law, keep dangerous criminals off our streets, and help former inmates get a second chance at life. And a second chance that many of them will really succeed at, if only given the chance.
Well, that's pretty hard to be against. There are three specific things this bill does. First, it gives increased access to a lot of different classes and treatments, including substance abuse treatment, vocational training, and academic classes. Now, I hear most of you saying, Steven, prison already has all of those things. And yeah, it does. But this changes incentives and funding. So I'd like to reference the bill directly, but there's a lot of C subsection D, and then subsection D tells you to refer to section 1. It's basically a choose your own adventure, except with legislation. The important thing to know is that the bill encourages inmates to participate in more vocational and rehabilitative programs, by letting them get earned time credits that allow them to be released early to halfway houses or home confinement. Now, don't worry everyone, they're not doing this for moral purposes, they're doing it because it works. Extensive research that was cited in this bill has been done by the RAND Foundation, a centrist think tank, and they found that
if an individual participates in any type of correctional education program, whether it be adult basic ed, GED preparation, college education, or vocational training, they had a 13 percentage point reduction in their risk of being reincarcerated. In other words, participants have a 43% lower chance of returning to prison than their counterparts. If you break that down to dollars involved, educating one inmate ranges from $2,000 to $4,000 a year, while incarceration for the same person ranges from $30,000 to $40,000 annually. Every dollar invested in prison education programs will save taxpayers between $4 and $5 in reincarceration costs.
So let me see if I heard you right. Less crime, a more educated and productive population, and 400-500% savings? This might be easier for Trump to pass than a cognitive test. So what's up with the money? Because we have more people wanting to take these programs now. That's gonna cost us. Well, first, there's authorized to be appropriated to carry out this title $50 million for each of the fiscal years between 2019 and 2023. The only time liberals will support appropriation, and it's one heck of a good time to do it. Furthermore, remember how it's estimated that every dollar spent will lead to between $4 and $5 in savings? Well, the bill says any savings associated with reductions in recidivism that result from this title should be reinvested. Well, this might soon become some of the best funded public education in the country. Someday people might say, well, I applied to San Quentin, but Rikers is my safety prison. The last thing this bill does is bring in a system similar to earned time credits called good time credits, which sounds like a code for conjugal visits if I've ever heard one. These systems already exist in our prison.
The Attorney General and a group of lawmakers want to change the rules that allow prisoners to earn time off for good behavior.
So if this already exists, what are we talking about? Well, you can currently earn a 47-day advance release for every year served for good behavior. And this would boost that number, so you could now earn an extra week every year. Okay, I'll grant you that that isn't exactly as groundbreaking as the first point, but that'll help those goody-two-shoes inmates get back to society a few weeks early. Finally, don't worry, these coins for going to classes and being nice will not be able to be cashed in by inmates who are deemed high risk by an algorithm. But this algorithm idea is catching some flack, too. If you have a racist guy or a guy who doesn't like poor people, not sure if that second one has an official name, besides capitalist, he could create an algorithm that could highlight the fact that those two groups have higher recidivism rates, and not give them the same access to reduced sentences as other people. Now, before I talk about the controversy that this bill is currently undergoing, there are some other very random and specific things that this bill mandates, including...
Pregnant women have been restrained with handcuffs, leg irons, even waist chains. Doctors say shackling can seriously increase health risks for both mother and child, and human rights groups have called it demeaning and unnecessary.
Well, in big letters and all caps, like a Trump tweet on steroids, this bill says restraints on pregnant prisoners prohibited. Actually, this covers the period of pregnancy, labor, and postpartum recovery. Although no one's making a run for it during labor. We have one suspect, make that two suspects on the run. This ban starts the moment when pregnancy is confirmed by a healthcare professional. Which, wow, that sounds more progressive than I think most progressives would go. There's even more for family visitation purposes. Subject to bed availability, the prisoner's security designation, the prisoner's programmatic needs, and the prisoner's mental and medical health needs, place the prisoner in a facility as close as practical to the prisoner's primary residence. It goes on to say that the prisoner has to be held within 500 driving miles of his primary residence, unless he requests to remain in his current facility. Which, wow, passive-aggressive much? Yeah, I'm just trying to get a little time away from the wife. Do you have any prisons in Alaska? I swear, there's so many things in this bill that read like chicken soup for the politically exhausted soul. We're talking the first official de-escalation training, evidence-based treatment for opium and heroin abuse programs, ensuring supervision of released sexually dangerous persons, and with the Me Too movement going the way it is, that could create quite a few jobs. Hey, at least someone's going to be showing up to Cosby's next show. And if you hate all of that, we'll have fun not agreeing with a pilot program to equip prisoners with the skills to provide training and therapy to animals seized by the federal law enforcement under asset forfeiture authority. Which, wow, we're seizing pets as assets. And to provide organizations that provide shelter and similar services to abandoned, rescued, or otherwise vulnerable animals. I mean, I never imagined I'd say this, but this prison reform bill might really make you feel good. Like, finally we're doing something objectively and uncontroversially smart. So, what's the catch? Well, both parties are split on this one. First, the Democrats. We recently saw Senators Cory Booker, Richard Durbin, and Kamala Harris, as well as Congress members Sheila Jackson and John Lewis, send a letter to the Senate urging them to vote no on this bill. Because the Democrats are starting to lay the groundwork for shooting themselves in the foot in the midterm. Now, their concern isn't with what's in the bill, nobody is in the pro-pregnant woman in chains camp. Instead, they're upset because it doesn't mention sentencing reform, specifically for mandatory minimum sentencing. Many are saying it's a bit strategic too as well, because sentencing reform probably wouldn't pass on its own in Congress. So you have to wrap it up with things everything like, so it might pass with bipartisan support. Kinda like slipping a ground-up pill into your kid's sandwich. If only we had that bill. Well, we did. 6 months ago, this was reported.
This week, there was bipartisan agreement on a bill to make major changes to the criminal justice system, especially for nonviolent drug offenders. This bill has been years in the making. The Senate Judiciary Committee overwhelmingly approved it. But on the eve of the committee's vote, Attorney General Jeff Sessions made it quite clear he does not support this bill.
That, unfortunately, happened the same day as the Stoneman Douglas shooting, so nobody ever heard about it, and it just kind of fizzled out. The bill, the Sentencing Reform and Corrections Act, was voted to the floor of the Senate and promptly forgotten about. It's actually still there if anyone wants to pick it up and vote on it. Advocates are saying that this is the bill they want to see either passed or incorporated into this first step bill. On the other side, you have Republicans who hate this bill, being led by a man so Midwest his last name is Cotton.
Cotton's comments caught the nation's attention when he said too many criminals are let go, contradicting many who say the nation incarcerates too many people.
If anything, we have an under-incarceration problem.
He views the sentence leniency for good behavior and knowledge acquired as soft on crime, and wants to see stiffer criminal penalties to keep convicts out of public for as long as possible. While the research shows that this is going to be ineffective at bringing down crime, a moral argument could be made. As Jared Kushner said when presenting this bill, the single biggest thing we want to do is really define what the purpose of a prison is. Is the purpose to punish? Is the purpose to warehouse? Or is the purpose to rehabilitate? Well, we'll find out soon, won't we? Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating Trump's cabinet, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly episodes. And give me a thumbs up, and as always, thank you for watching.